Live. Unscheduled live video. How's it going, guys? So, this video was completely unscheduled. And yes, I know it's very late for a lot of you. So, welcome. I've been too sick to do streams for some time, and I've felt better today. So, I was working on a video, and I figured I haven't streamed for ages. It's just in the tail end of Sunday for a lot of you guys. So I figured I'd make a video. And this is one I was going to do just as a normal, regular edited video. I've been asking a lot of people for their newbie questions. Like, questions you have, those burning ones when you start getting into 3D printing. And I figured I could answer them on stream because then I can answer your comments as well. So we got Sam. I can't keep up with the chat already. Welcome. So yeah, I've settled into the new workshop, the new studio. I've got various printers printing away at the moment. I've got the Wanhao i3 version 2. I've got the Prusa i3 version 2, Mark 2. The dreaded 101 Hero that's not printing away. That's a good lesson for newbies. Don't buy that. Anyway. So basically, I asked on Patreon like some questions as to... let me pop the chat out. Hold on. Pop out chat. There we go. Put that over there. And I can change to this. That should work. Nope. There we go. Hopefully that's working. I asked some questions on chat of newbie-like questions for 3D printing, and I'm going to answer them here on stream. Well, I'm going to try to. So let's see how it goes. So Joel asked loads of them, as you can see. So I'm going to go through them, and hopefully these will these will help some of you as well. Okay, so do you need an enclosure to print ABS? I would say yes, although you can print ABS plastic without an enclosure, but you need a fairly warm ambient temperature to stop it warping. So if your printer does not have an enclosure, you may struggle to print large ABS parts, and you definitely need a heated bed. Next one, will the fumes from my 3D printer hurt me? So there's currently a Kickstarter campaign at the moment, which is about a 3D printing fume filter kind of thing. I'm not sure that it will do much, judging by the size of it. Just to give you guys an idea, if I can show you down on the floor here. There you go. So to vent my room, I use this fan. It's an industrial size fan that blows air out the door. And that gives me a constant active airflow through the room and sucks air through. And it's not so much for the FDM 3D printers, it's more because the resin printers I'm testing at the moment have a very big smell. And yeah, so I have an active airflow, but I don't know if the fumes of 3D printing are really that big of a deal. Okay, let's see if I can do this again. So, I'm going to press the buttons. There we go. There we go. That should work, I think. Joel's also asking, if I spend more money, will I get a better printer? No. More money can buy you a better printer, but you can spend a lot of money on a piece of crap, and you can also spend not very much money on a very good printer, like a kit, if you're willing to put the time in. And I recently did a video, you guys would have seen it, on the 3D printers I recommend for $350 or less. So basically, you can spend $350 and get a really good 3D printing experience. Aaron's saying in the chat, I found a compromise in printing ABS without an enclosure. Heat mats as a sacrificial support material. So he's saying that at least 10 millimeters wide. Okay, so he's doing a thin layer out from the bed to give it more surface area. That does work. That can work. Joel's also asking, is dual extrusion worth it? I would say no. A lot of people getting 3D printing think dual extrusion is a fantastic idea. But honestly, unless your machine has the ability to move the nozzles independently, like the Sigma does, BCN Sigma has dual carriages, or the Ultimaker 3, the nozzles can move out of the way. Dual extrusion is a real pain in the butt. For example, the FlashForge Dreamer, Creator Pro have two nozzles which are fixed, and that second nozzle can wipe against the filament as it's printing, and it can smear colors together. I appreciate it, Dion. Thanks for jumping in. It's a weird time. But yeah, so the nozzles can smear, and dual extrusion, when you're first getting into 3D printing, I would recommend against it. So yeah, that's my say on that. And also, next question, what 3D printing pieces of 3D printing design software are cheap or free? My picks for starting in 3D printing would be Tinkercad, which is free, runs on the cloud, and is very powerful, but also very simple. Or what I'm using a lot now is Fusion 360, and thanks to a lot of you guys and your comments, I'm starting to use it, I guess, properly by using component-based modeling, that sort of thing. So Fusion 360 if you want to have very powerful parametric modeling, or Tinkercad if you're just getting started. Right. Joel asked a lot of questions. Is expensive filament better than cheap filament? Again, no. Filament can be had now for very, very cheap, and it usually prints great. I rarely come across filament these days that doesn't work very well. So basically, I spent like 10 bucks a kilo on some special ABS that was being sold by Hobby King over Christmas, like run out stock, and it prints beautifully. I've been having good success with it. So you generally spend more money on exotic filaments where you'd have like metal powders and that sort of thing. But yeah, you don't have to spend a lot of money to get good filament. And 3D Printing Lab is asking in this one, is it better to buy a cheap machine or expensive? Again, going back to Joel's question, yeah, it's better to buy the machine that you, best machine you can afford, I would say. that 3D print guy, no bourbon, unfortunately, not yet. I've just got some water. Yeah, classic pork in the chat saying, don't buy eBay or AliExpress filament. Yeah, you can go too cheap, as with everything, but you can just get cheap stuff and it usually works great. Another question I get asked a lot is in 3D Print Labs asking, what's the use of 2.85 versus 1.75 millimeter filament? So the 3D printing hobby, I guess, industry has settled on two standards, and it's actually three standards. You have 1.75 millimeter filament, which is this stuff, quite thin and easy to work with. And then you have 2.85 millimeter filament, but you also have 3 millimeter filament, and that's come as a bit of a misunderstanding. One of the largest companies that uses 2.85 would be Ultimaker, and because of their tolerances, they can't run some 3 millimeter filament. It's just the diameter of the filament, and machines are designed to take one or the other. So some 3 millimeter filament machines can probably take 2.85, but the Ultimaker probably can't take cheap quality 3 millimeter. It might not be dimensionally accurate enough. But I use 1.75 millimeter on all my machines, and it's very easy to work with, but doesn't work so well in a Bowden-driven 3D printer. And yep, so Jeffrey, again, asking the same question. 3 millimeter and 1.75 can't be used on the same machine. It's one or the other. I can't keep up with the chat. Mitch is asking another good beginner question. Should I buy the original Prusa i3 Mark II as a first printer? So I would say yes, if you can afford it. It is an expensive machine for what you get, but it is fantastic. If you can't afford it, then I would probably look at the Wanhao i3 version 2.1, something like that. Right, next questions. Joel is asking, can I make money from 3D printing? Doing 3D printing, and I get asked this a lot. Is there any money in 3D printing? And I can tell you, I used to work in a 3D printing on-demand studio, so we would print files for people. Yes, you can do it, and yes, you can make money from it, but it's a lot harder than it used to be, because as these machines have gotten cheaper, so why would someone pay you a few hundred dollars for a 3D print if the machine you have only cost you a few hundred dollars? So it's more on the service side of things now. If you have the skills to 3D design and then print as an all-in-one package, that makes you more valuable to someone. So if you want to take their idea to a prototype, that you can definitely charge money for. 3D hubs, printing on demand, it may be an unpopular opinion, but I'm going to say no, you can't really make money from it. You can maybe cover cost of consumables, but you can't really make a living off it. I've gone to do this on YouTube, this 3D printing channel, because I didn't want to print on demand. I wanted to do one thing and share it with thousands of people by doing tutorials and that sort of thing. And Soundboard, thank you so much for your contribution. So you're asking, what's my favorite print I've ever made? I would probably say the Torture Lattice Cubes that I printed last year. They're one of my favorites in terms of how, I guess, how they became adopted by the community and people were using them to test their printers. But I do actually have a My Little Pony figurine, which was one of my first ones, which I vapor smoothed in one of my first videos two or three years ago or so. And I still have it. It's going to feature in an upcoming video on how long 3D prints last, because it has actually degraded somewhat. But I still got that, and I do like that print. It's one of my first few vapor smooth prints. Right. Jeffrey is asking, what kind of filament is easiest to print with? Definitely PLA. If you're starting with 3D printing, go with PLA. It's simple, it's not going to warp on you, and it's not very dangerous. It's made from starch, so it's biodegradable, renewable, and it has a fairly nice smell to it. So yeah, PLA all the way. Philippe's question's a little bit detailed for this stream. I'm probably going to go into that in a different video, though I do have a 3D printing 101 on first layer settings. I'll jump back to the chat to see if what I've got here. Okay. So ak 2323 is asking, why is the bottom part of a sphere print with bad resolution on some printers? I actually did a really old video on printing upside down. I took a 3D printer and physically turned it upside down to see if I could alleviate this issue. And it's caused because when you're printing a sphere, the bottom of that sphere has very little surface contact. So when it prints the next layers on top of it, it's got nothing to stick to. It's not nothing to rest on. So it starts to deform and droop slightly. So what you'll get when you print a sphere is the bottom surface until about 45 degrees or so. That seems to be the magic number. Will be quite rough. They'll be quite terrible. But then once it gets past that, it looks good. So if you're printing a round object, I would recommend printing it in halves and gluing them together to get the best finish. You can't do good underside curves on an FDM 3D printer at all. It's just, forget it, even on expensive ones. And Mir asked me, and these are from Patreon, by the way. I asked these questions and they got answered. So what is parametric CAD and what are its benefits? So parametric CAD is different to, for example, Tinkercad, because you can go back and change dimensions and things will auto update. So let's say I designed this bottle. I did design a bottle recently. Let's say I designed this one and I drew it as a sketch and I gave it dimensions and revolved it. Then I wanted to go back and make this bottle twice the height for some reason, or maybe twice the size in the diameter. I could go back to my sketch, update those dimensions, and everything down the tool chain updates. So the bottle will update. That's parametric CAD, parametric computer-aided design. And I learned SolidWorks at university, and that's just how my mind works. I must design with parametric modeling in mind. And it does take longer to set up that foundation, but once you have it, you can go back and change easily. If you don't do that, you have to remodel the whole thing, which gets tricky and can waste time. All right, going back to here, Philippe was asking, will TPU rip up my PEI build plate? And that's interesting, because if you're printing with flexible materials, you do need to be careful of your first layer adhesion. You might be thinking TPU or flexible materials are hard to stick down, but usually it's the opposite. You can usually accidentally weld them to your print surface, especially build tack. If you're printing with build tack on your surface with your first layer in flexibles, maybe change your distance a little bit further away than normal to stop it welding. There's a lot of chat in, there's a lot of talk in the chat about the Teva tarantula. Okay, guys, I have to break it. There's not going to be a part two of that video. There will be another video concluding the saga that was the Teva tarantula, or the machine that I was sent later on, but it came down to me rebuilding it into another machine. And the final straw were these rollers right here. So I went to use them. When you tighten up screws into these rollers, they bind up. So you can't tighten them up, therefore you can't make the frame rigid. There's a video coming on it, but basically there will not be a part two. I hope that summarizes it. Sorry. Okay, next question. I can't do the Boris one, it's a bit too complicated. Here we go. Jeffrey's asking one. So how do I know what nozzle size to use on my printer and what's the difference? So when you buy a 3D printer, FDM 3D printer, it may come with a different nozzle size to what you expect. The standard is 0.4 millimeter diameter. Most machines will come with that, which means that the nozzle diameter, it extrudes a line of plastic that's 0.4 millimeters in diameter, right? But you can get different sizes. You can get 0.5, 0.6, 0.25. So you can get different sizes, and it's really important to know what size your machine has, because you need to set your slicer settings to reflect that. Imagine you have a 0.2 millimeter nozzle, then the infill has to be set at the right spacing for that nozzle, whereas a 0.6 would have a different spacing. So obviously 0.2 will give you more detail, but 0.6 will print a lot faster and actually dramatically faster. So 0.4 seems to be the standard, but if you're printing larger things, you might want to upgrade that to a 0.6 or 0.8 millimeter nozzle, or even some machines like E3D sell on their Volcano hot end a 1.2 millimeter nozzle to print stuff really fast, but you do lose detail. Yeah, so you guys are commenting on the new version of the Tarantula, which has washers in it so it doesn't bind. I totally understand that, but that's not what I was sent as a reviewer. Therefore, that's just how it is. I mean, manufacturers send me what I need to review, and I can't review the newer versions because that's not what I was sent. Moving on. Jeffrey is asking in the chat, or in the Patreon chat, what should I use, when should I use a raft when printing? So the 3D printing community is divided between people who use rafts and people who don't use rafts. And some people who don't use rafts swear that they are like the dumbest thing in the world. There's a few cases where rafts can be really handy. First of all, what is a raft? It's a very thin layer, a couple of layers thick, of plastic that's laid down really coarse before your print is started. So your print builds on top of the raft. But that means you have to break it away afterwards. It takes longer to print because you need to print the raft, and it wastes plastic. So you might be thinking, why would you do that? Well, it makes it easier to start a print without the bed being perfectly layered, perfectly level. And also, it also helps with support materials. So when you're doing a column of support material, it might break free if it's straight onto the print surface. But with a raft, it's going plastic onto plastic, which means it's more likely to stay in place. So I use rafts when I want to do complicated support structures. But if I'm printing something that's flat, fairly simple, you want to go raftless. But keep in mind, you do want to make sure your bed level is perfectly dialed in. Thank you very much. I, Captain Tristan, sorry, I can't pronounce your first name. You're asking, can I splice my Z-axis motor leads to get all the control, the Z-axis from one driver plug? Yes, you can. So a lot of manufacturers, what he's asking is a lot of 3D printers, especially i3 style, where they have the two lead screws, will have two motors. And basically what you're asking is, can you join those motors' wires together into the one motor driver? And you definitely can. A lot of manufacturers do that from the factory. And although you are going to put more load on that driver, for a 3D printer, realistically, you're not going to run into much of an issue. So you definitely can. I think actually most printers do that. Just make sure you get them all, the coils correct, or you might end up with a short. So yeah, but double check it with a multimeter. And one final one from Patreon. Luke was asking, should I buy an acrylic frame or will my soul be ripped down to printer hell and tortured for eternity? Oh man. Okay. Acrylic frames for a 3D printer, they can be done. You can get a good 3D printer with an acrylic frame, but it is brittle. I will not lie to you. There is a chance if you buy a 3D printer kit with an acrylic frame, some parts may be cracked and broken. Acrylic laser cuts very easily and it's very cheap, which means it's great for a low-cost kit. It's actually quite dimensionally stable as well, but it is very brittle. So keep that in mind. If you're buying an acrylic kit or you're working with an acrylic kit, you might need to get some spares. Not all the time, but sometimes. Yeah, and Shivel's actually adding back to Tristan your comment before onto splicing the motor wires together. You do have to watch out for the adjustments for when you're leveling the gantry. You need to do that manually with the motors turned off, because when you jog one motor, the other one will jog. So you need to do it manually to level up your gantry. Yeah. And Luke is also adding that lasering acrylic does make it brittle. Not all types. You can get toughened acrylics, but you're very unlikely to see those types in a 3D printed kit. Okay, more questions from Patreon. Jeffrey is asking, is it okay to store my filament in an open environment? I get asked this one a load of times. So, there's this idea that 3D printing filament needs to be kept in an airtight container, sealed away from everything. Yes, in an ideal world, you do. And that's because some types of filaments will either become brittle when exposed to air or absorb moisture and print poorly. Nylon is a perfect example of that. Nylon filaments absorb moisture within days. So when you open up nylon filament, you start printing with it, it prints awesome, it's so strong. But then a few days later, it starts bubbling, spitting, stringing, because it's absorbed moisture. So you need to keep those filaments in an enclosed chamber. It's got desiccant to absorb moisture and keep it dry. And the reason I've got this one here is this is Cocoon Create brand PLA. This is what I got I received last year with the Cocoon Create to review it. And I think, if I'm correct, it's become brittle. So it should, there you go. Not all of it, but yeah. So as it gets closer into the roll, it's not brittle anymore. And as I warm it up with my hands, it becomes less brittle. But PLA, when it's exposed to the elements, seems to get brittle. Not all brands, but some definitely. And you may have a Bowden-style extruder with filament that you leave overnight and come back to it, and it's cracked all in the tube. Some of you guys experienced with 3D printing might have seen that. That tends to happen because you're straightening out the filament from what it's been, stored in. It's been stored in a coil, and you're straightening it out. Then because of that, it starts to crack. So to answer your question, I store most of my filament in an open environment, but I tend to store it in boxes at least to keep the dust out. That seems to help, but yeah, some filaments are much worse than others. Just put my filament in Joel's filament wall and everything will be fine. Absolutely, Joel's filament wall is legendary. I'm not sure you can see it, but I don't have as much filament as Joel does at all. Right. Rick asked a question, how do I avoid that look for my wife when my next 3D printer is delivered? Unfortunately, Rick, that's probably a problem I can't solve for you. At least personally, my better half kind of just makes sure, she's like, you have to leave it in this room and I'm going to pretend it doesn't exist. That's how I deal with it. So Chris was asking a great question about build volume, and I get this asked one a lot from those who are looking to buy a 3D printer. Do I need a bigger printer? I want to buy a 3D printer with a big build volume. What should I get? Don't fall down that trap. And I'm going to tell you why. So a bigger 3D printer sounds awesome. You can print larger things. But you need to keep in mind that you may have a print, for example, a 20mm cube that might take 1 hour to print. It doesn't, but that's just say 1 hour to print. If you double that size, so times it by 200%, it's now a 40mm cube, 40, 40, 40. That's not going to take 2 hours to print extra. It's going to take maybe roughly 8 hours because it's increasing eight times. And the thing is, that's a very poor way to explain it. But basically, as you make objects larger, it's not an increase in, two times. It's an increase by a factor. So when you have a 3D printer that's got a build volume this big, you're looking at days of print time. Joel Telling over his channel, 3D Printing Nerd, did a massive hairy line recently that went for ages. I can't remember how long, but it was like 80 hours or something. It was massive. And you have to think, that printer could have failed at any point and that print would have been ruined. So as a beginner, I would recommend a print volume of around 150 millimeters. I know it sounds small, but really you're still looking at 6 hours, 8 hours easy print time on some prints in that volume. And if you want bigger, just slice it up using a program like Mesh Mixer and join it together. If you can join PLA together with a 2-minute epoxy, 2-part epoxy, works very well. And you can just sand it, no one will know the difference. And you're also avoiding the risk of that whole print failing halfway through and losing the whole thing. So don't fall down the trap of getting a massive build volume printer. They're also harder to dial in that first layer because the bed's bigger. So yeah, that's going to be my recommendation for those sort of people wanting bigger printers. Okay. Local inventors, what's a good 3D printer for under $300? Well, under $350, you can go watch my video, and that will help you. Okay. Cool. So Rick also asked a really interesting question on heated beds. So should my heated bed be hot or cold when removing my prints to make it easier? So if your printer's just finished printing, you might think, I'm going to rush in and take the print off, and then, because I've been waiting for it for hours, hold that thought. So if you've been printing with PLA plastic, it's got what's called a fairly low glass transition temperature. So what will happen is, because that plastic, if you have a heated bed, has been sitting there, it's a little bit flexible, it's a little bit soft. And if you reach in with a spatula and pry it off, you're going to bend your 3D print. You're going to damage it before it's even had a chance to set. So what I would recommend for most printing surfaces, glass and print bite, which is a Garolite, like a fiberglass surface, I would recommend letting it cool down completely. And often prints will self-release, they'll just pop off. PEI and build tack can be a little bit different. PEI tend to let, that's on the Prusa i3 Mark II, that's what it comes with. I tend to let that cool down completely, but in the case where you can't get the print off easily, you can sometimes re-warm it, and it can make it easier, but be careful of damaging your prints, taking them off. And that especially applies to also PETG, because that prints at a higher temperature, you need a heated bed usually, but it also softens at quite a low temperature, same as PLA. I'm ignoring your question, Bruce. Right, Michael's asking, do I need a heated bed to print in PETG? I used to think yes, and I would still recommend for a beginner, yes, heated bed, heated to around 50 degrees or so. But I have been proven wrong. You can print PETG without a heated bed. I have done it successfully, but it's a little bit more difficult. You need sort of a print, build tack style surface, and you need a really good first layer adhesion. Print slow and print hot, 240 degrees or so, depending on the brand of PETG. And you can get it to work, absolutely. But you may still encounter warping, especially higher up the print, where it might start curling up, depending on the brand. So I would recommend a heated bed, but you can try it. It does work on the Cetus. I did try the recycled PET recently and it failed, but I have tried another brand of PETG and it worked. So you can do it. Right. Tom's asking, do PEI and PETG play well together, I suppose? I printed the PET initially on my PEI surface on the Prusa i3 Mark II, and that did work. That worked fine. But, I'm not sure. It may... if you print a large piece, I would be careful of your layer adhesion. And Bruce, thank you so much. I do appreciate it. I think I missed a call from you about a week ago. I'll send you an email after this stream. Okay. And another question from Patreon. What is axis shift and how should I fix it? So if you've ever 3D printed a tall object and it's sort of gone off, like it's gone up about halfway and then shifted and then continued, it's really obvious and it's really frustrating. And that's caused when your 3D printer loses steps. So a 3D printer uses what's called a stepper motor that is given discrete movements. But that motor doesn't have any feedback. So what you can do with a 3D printer, if you've accidentally driven it into a corner or something, it makes a horrible clunking noise, but nothing really gets damaged because that motor just loses steps. It goes click, 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 click as it can't turn. So what happens when you're 3D printing, if you run too fast or your current on your motors is too low, or if there's some binding in your mechanism, for example, as we said before, the dual vertical lead screws, if the gantry is bent, skewed, you might lose steps. And that is evident in your print with a shift in the layers. And it's really frustrating. So if that happens, increase your current, slow your print down, and maybe investigate if your print is binding up in some way. All right, what else do I have in this list? So many of you guys on Patreon sent me awesome questions. Okay, so 3D Print Aspie asked me, what is the best way to print, prepare for the switch of testing out ABS or other exotic filaments, such as filaments, nylons, carbon, glow-in-the-dark? What parts need changing? Okay, so if you want to 3D print, you might have heard there's fiber-filled filaments, carbon fiber, or even glow-in-the-dark filaments. But it's important to know that these filaments are quite nasty, and they're nasty because they're abrasive. So a usual nozzle on a 3D printer is made from brass, I suppose, and that's quite a soft metal. So when the filaments go through, they actually, like, imagine running like sandpaper through it, they start abrading it out. So when you want to print these more fancy materials, you're going to need to use what's called a hardened nozzle. So a nozzle that's much harder to resist these filaments. And you can get them from different manufacturers. They might be stainless steel, which is a little bit harder, but not massively so, or hardened steel, or even tungsten nozzles. They do exist now from some manufacturers. And you can use these nozzles to print these materials. Even glow-in-the-dark, depending on the brand, has abrasive pigment. It can actually chew out a nozzle. So that's something to watch out for. They usually print fine, those materials, except the nylon. Nylon's hard to print, but you need to keep in mind that they will chew through and usually damage the PTFE lining if you've got that as well. Cool. And another question from Rick, how do I know if my nozzle has a clog and how do I clear it? So if your 3D printer, when it's printing, clicks and it doesn't make a nice strand of filament, it doesn't extrude properly, you see like little like wisps coming out, that's a clog or a partial clog. Also, if you extrude filament and it curls off to one side and sticks to the nozzle, that's a partial clog as well. So you can clear it out by using, I think a lot of machines like the Prusa i3 ship with like an acupuncture needle now. But I'm not sure how well they work. I used to use a 0.4mm drill bit or whatever size the nozzle is, that size drill bit. Warm the thing up and gently twizzle, I guess, I think that's the right word, into the nozzle and then purge some filament through to clear that blockage. Sometimes you can't get it clear, but nozzles are pretty cheap these days. But that's how I do it. Also, you can use, as I said before, nylon filament absorbs moisture and becomes water damaged and pops and spits. You can actually use nylon filament to steam clean a nozzle by heating the nozzle up and putting nylon through it that's being water damaged, and it will like pop and spit the crap out. That does work sometimes. Also, you can do what's called a cold pull, which I'm not going to go into detail here. There's some great other YouTube channels that go into what a cold pull is, which can sometimes save you. Otherwise, get a new nozzle. I'm smashing through my water. I'm still am a bit sick, so I do apologize. Tesla's asking a great question. Can you use any nozzle on your hot end? No, you can't. Different brands of hot ends have different thread sizes and different specifications and different internal details on their nozzles. So some are quite standard now, like the E3D style ones. They're quite popular, unfortunately, because of the Chinese clones that exist. But some others, like the nozzle on the Up box and the Up 3D printers, is an internally threaded nozzle and it's very specific. So you can't really just buy knockoffs. So definitely find out what your machine needs. I mean, like the Mark 10 extruders on the Wanhao i3 machines have a M7 thread. I mean, who uses M7? But they have it, so you need to get those types. Okay, I'm gonna just knock through this list. And Rick asked, how do I make sure to know when Maker's Muse or 3D Printing Nerd post new videos? Well, that's a good question as well. You need to be subscribed, but also there's a bell icon now on YouTube. So YouTube's doing weird things, and if you want to get a notification, you need to hit that bell icon. Otherwise, it won't usually tell you. It's just random. I'm not saying you have to do it, but if you want to make sure you get these stream notifications instantly, you need to hit that icon. Am I a Make Anything fan? Absolutely I am. Devin is an absolute champ. His designs are amazing. He is an incredible industrial designer. I love his stuff. So yes, I am definitely a fan of Make Anything. Cool. These ones. Okay, is it another good one? Then I'll move on. So what if I run out of filament on the spool before my print is done? So a lot of you may be wondering, you have a spool of filament, you're printing, and the spool runs dry. What does your 3D printer do? Well, 99% of the case, it will just try to keep printing and it will print air. Even in 2017, most 3D printers don't have a spool, empty spool detector, a filament detector. And even if they do, they don't usually detect if it's stopped extruding. Like if you get a jam, there's still filament in the path, but it's not extruding. They usually don't have anything. So there's only a few machines on the market that do. It's very easy to add your own, either with a buzzer and a micro switch, or even you could plug into Octoprint to pause. Something I might do a video on in the future, actually. But for most part, keep an eye on your 3D printers. Never print unattended. And for the most part, if the filament runs out, your print will just air print, unfortunately. Okay. Last couple of few ones. What is artifacting on prints and what causes it? It's probably a little bit too broad, but if your print has issues and you know your hardware is good, then slicer settings can make a big difference in terms of how your print looks. So I would definitely consult on Facebook the group for that 3D printer and see what their optimum settings are. Otherwise, it may be a hardware issue. Soundboard, thank you. Do I have a Maker coin? Oh, do I have a Maker coin? Yes, I do. So I'm not going to say I invented it, but I designed the Maker coin last year as a way to 3D print swatches, like small amounts of filament. And the idea just exploded. So I have, I'll just show you. Here you go. Yes, I have a lot of Maker coins. I did this for the Maker Fair in Sydney last year, and there's still tons left. So yeah, I do have a Maker coin, and that video should be somewhere on the channel. Okay, one more one from this one. Hans was asking, what's an easy thing to check to see if my model's even printable? So you can easily send files to a 3D printer that aren't even capable of being printed. I recommend checking out Mesh Mixer for a start. I have lots of tutorials on fixing files in Mesh Mixer. But if you load it into your slicing program and there's lots of impossibly thin or zero thickness surfaces or errors do pop up, that's a bad sign. Don't even try to print it. But yeah, you might want to fire up something like Mesh Mixer, which will instantly tell you and show you if something's wrong. And you can fix it in that software, or you can use like the NetFab, Cloud Engine, or 3D Builder in Windows 10 to fix files as well. Alright, and David, I'll do one from David. My prints won't stick to my bed. How do I stop this? So there's a few things you can use to add adhesion to your print surface. You can use regular old glue sticks. I have something I bought from the local, it's like a Korean brand glue stick, and that works. Also, you can use purpose-made solutions like Magigoo. That works very well. And you can even use some brands of hairspray, though I've personally never had any good luck with hairspray. I might be buying the wrong brand. But you can also, you can add any sort of adhesive that gives that first layer more purchase, and that'll help it stick. And then he's saying, I can't remove my print from the bed. What do I do? I recommend a very thin, sharp scraper, but please watch my video on scraper blade safety, because it's very dangerous. Right. And Kevin was asking, what place do I recommend getting filament from? I get asked this question a lot. I'm going to just go back to the full screen so you can see my lovely face. In terms of filament, you need to buy it from somewhere local, because shipping's a killer. So even for me, Hobby King's the cheapest. The shipping for many other people is just too expensive. Oh, thank you so much for the tip, Master PJ555. Did I check out Chinese Mother smoothie boards? Oh, smoothie boards. No, I haven't yet, actually. I do have a friend in Shenzhen. So the AZSMZ, I haven't seen that one. I know there's a few 32-bit boards coming out of China now, and they are on my radar, because 32-bit gives you far superior smoothing control over your 3D print versus the standard Arduinos and that sort of thing. So yeah, definitely check out in the future. I am planning to upgrade some printers to smoothie board control. Hey, Joel's in here. Welcome. Hey, how long did your hairy lion print, Joel? Because I was making a case against why newbies shouldn't buy a big format printer, because it just takes so long. Charles was asking, how would I convince my mother to let me buy a 3D printer? Well, that's a good question. It took me ages to convince my parents to buy me anything, any sort of remote control stuff for robotics. for the combat robots I was building. I ended up getting it for a Christmas birthday present combined. So maybe just say you want it for a Christmas birthday present combined. But also, it's very valuable, so maybe direct them to this channel. Show them what I'm making with 3D printers, and maybe it's a better investment than another gaming console. Who was asking about food safe filament? Food safe filament, okay. So there's a bit of a misconception over food safe filament for 3D printing. Yes, PETG, most brands are food safe, but the 3D printed objects are not food safe. And that's for two reasons. One, once you run them through the 3D printing nozzle, who knows what you've printed through that nozzle? You might have printed carbon fiber filament, you might have printed something with lead in it, I don't know. But really, realistically, it's no longer food safe once you do that. But even if it was, a 3D print has layers in it, and those layers trap bacteria. You can't guarantee that you'll be able to clean it unless you put it into an autoclave. And if you put any 3D print into an autoclave, you're going to end up with a ball of goop at the end. It's just going to destroy it. So yes and no. While you probably are okay using it as a cookie cutter, I wouldn't use it as a cup or a bowl, something that you reuse like that, because there's more than likely bacteria is going to get trapped between those layers, and that's what's going to cause the problem, not the plastic itself. Donald was asking, what's the longest time length, the longest print I ever did, and what printer did I use? So the longest print I ever did was 60 hours. It was a traffic cone style print for a customer about 30 centimeters high. The reason it took so long is I used the Mancati XT, or whatever it was called, which was a Ultimaker clone, and it was very bad. The temperature management was very poor. I had to print at 15 millimeters per second. And that's why it took so long. So that was the longest print I've ever done. And okay, Prying Variables asking, should I be regularly replacing my print head? No, not really. You'd only want to replace your print head if it got damaged. The wear surfaces in a printing extruder are, you depending on the brand, they're usually looking at the PTFE lined tube. So the tube that's in it, if it's a PTFE lined extruder, that's definitely a consumable. So you're going to have to replace that every, I don't know, depending on how much you're printing, I'd say 6 months. You just buy a meter of it off eBay for $3 or something. It's pretty cheap. And your nozzle's definitely a consumable, but again, I would have a spare on hand, and you can usually clear them out. But to get the best printing options possible, I would replace your nozzle, again, probably every 6 months or maybe a year. Again, if you're printing just as a hobby now and then, you're probably never going to have to replace it. If you're printing as a service constantly, probably every 6 months. Classic Pork. How do I reduce stepper motor whine? So if your 3D printer makes a load of noise from your motors, it's usually because they've been dialed up too high in terms of their current. The more current they get, the louder they are. Also, depending on your micro-stepping. Your machine might not be micro-stepping as much as your control board allows. Some boards will allow 1 to 32 if it's like a smoothie board, I believe, or maybe 1 to 16 micro-stepping. But if you're doing like 1 to 4 or whatever, like, or even full steps, it's going to be very loud. So reduce your current, but then you reduce torque. So be careful on that. Also, put your machine on like a noise absorbing foam tile. I use EVA stuff, you can probably see it there, and that works really well in absorbing noises as well. Right. Trying to keep up on everything. Alright, I'm going to read out some other questions, but I won't change the view. And so one of the questions I get asked a lot is what I do with failed prints, and that's something that a lot of newcomers want to know for 3D printing. What do you do with it? Like, you will end up inevitably with a lot of failed prints. And it depends on the plastic. So I did recently talk about it in my refill video. Recycled PET. Most countries don't have a system for unmarked plastic recycling. Apparently some do. They use a spectrometer, I think, to detect what type of plastic is, which is really cool. Australia doesn't have that at all. We're too backwards. We only have marked plastic recycling. So you can't recycle it, basically. So I try to collect it together, And I did see Devin on his channel Make Anything did some cool recycling projects with PLA. But yeah, realistically, there's not much of a way to recycle filament, especially into new filament. It's a nice idea, but right now it's not really feasible, unfortunately. That 3D print guy. Oh man, thank you. Which energy drink produces the best 3D prints? I do recall someone was going to be making a Red Bull filament at one stage, but that never happened, sadly. I am trying to stop drinking them every day, actually. Although I probably will end up shifting to iced coffee, which is not much better. Iced coffee filament. The original Red Eye was better, Shivel. I don't really like the platinum. I think it tastes like lemonade. Someone got called out. Could I make my plastic marked by adding a mark on the model? Possibly. I did think of that. You could possibly mark your own filament for recycling. I'm not sure what legal ramifications could come from that, because I'm sure there's some sort of certification that they have to go through. I don't know. I just 3D print stuff. I'm not really knowledgeable of that. Something that I did get asked a lot in a recent video is it vase or vase? Yes, I know it can be confusing for some people, but there is different pronunciations for the word. So I say vase mode 3D printing, and it does throw a lot of people off. But I am in Australia. We pronounce the word vase, not vase. Sorry. That's like my most popular video ever, and I think it's because I said it vase, not vase. When I go over to America, which I hope to for the New York Maker Fair, I'm not sure. I'm just going to intentionally tell everyone I print in vase mode and just watch them get confused. Shane is asking, is PETG just a strong PLA or is it more brittle? So PETG is actually a completely different type of plastic, and it is tougher than PLA, maybe not tougher than a modified PLA, but it can print it at a higher temperature, so a little bit more resistant to those temperatures, and you usually get it in nice translucent colors. That's why people like PETG. You can get it in really nice water clear colors. It makes really good lighting projects. So yeah, it's a different beast. Not better, not worse. Right. Michael's asking, are there any upgrades to the Cetus? I think they recently announced a heated bed upgrade, although I wouldn't bother on my Cetus, because honestly, I would only print PLA on the Cetus, and you don't need a heated bed for PLA. So I did see that. I would be wary of it. Honestly, the Cetus is great at doing what it does, and I wouldn't bother... I wouldn't modify it in any way. Oh, Joel, you didn't have to do that. So thank you so much, 3D Printing Nerd. If you haven't subscribed to 3D Printing Nerd, please do head over to his channel. So you're saying, what 3D innovations in 3D printing do you think we'll see by the end of the year? Right. So what we're already starting to see with the Ultimaker 3, is soluble support that works. That was another newbie question I had. Should you bother with soluble supports? Previously, I would have said no, because often the choices were something like PVA, which is PVA glue, can be made into filament. It's very moisture sensitive. That can be used as a soluble support for PLA prints, but it's very difficult to work with. Somehow Ultimakers made it work, and that's pretty cool. So we're going to see that become easier and more uptake of soluble supports that work. And resin printing. I made that prediction at the start of this year. That big black thing. If you guys are going to the Rep Rap Festival this weekend and you see a machine like that, go say Angus sent you. So resin printing is becoming increasingly cheap. Ridiculously cheaper, actually. And that 3D printer, the recommended retail price, I'm not sure on as yet. It's going to be a Kickstarter program. But it can print at 25 microns if you like. Here's a recent test. So that's 3D infill done through mesh mixer. Printed at, I think this one's only 100 microns, so it's actually pretty coarse for a resin printer. But resin printing is going to become increasingly cheaper. The Duplicator 7 is a 400 US DLP. So we're going to see more of that. And third one, I don't know. I think, Joel, you're going to hit 100,000 subscribers. That's probably the third innovation and prediction for this year. Luke, yes, the support material I had in Shenzhen, I haven't had a 1.75mm dual extrusion machine to test it on. That's basically why I haven't tested it, sadly. Right, I'm just going to go through any more of my questions I stored up. Oh yeah, that's not really relevant, but a lot of people are asking about the music in my videos, and I've said it before, but basically I make my own music. There's a keyboard there, covered in stuff. So it's just a hobby, really, but it lets me make videos without having to worry about copyright strikes for videos that have music in them that I might have taken. And you can find them on my SoundCloud. So if you just search Angus Deverson SoundCloud, you can find those songs. Right, any more questions? Probably going to finish up in a short period of time. So Anthony is asking, what have I seen as far as the price with resin-style printers? So going back on that, the price is dropping on the hardware, but also it's dropping massively on the resin. So a few years ago, you would have had to pay, I don't know, $400 Australian for half a litre of UV-curable resin for 3D printing. The Asiga systems, that's still really expensive resin. They're really good machines, but the resin's crazy expensive. Now, you can get Fun to Do resin, that is the company's name, Fun to Do, for like $65 a litre, maybe. And it's not maybe the strongest, but it's works fine. You can get good prints off it. And for 3D printing with resin, you're going to get amazing detail. So you can do figurines, paint it, and yeah, it's just becoming so cheap. The only problem with SLA and DLP, which are both resin-based systems, is they're messy. Really messy. I almost had a massive catastrophe. This is a rental. The floor is wooden. I don't think my landlord's ever going to see this, but I almost spilt like a whole vat of resin on the floor. Didn't happen, but it almost happened, and that would have been a nightmare. So yeah, resin is messy. Let's just leave it there. Classic Pork, do I love you guys? Yes, I do. Of course I do. You guys enable this. I love doing this. I love sharing my experiences, and it's only possible thanks to you guys jumping in this chat and sharing your experiences with me and sharing your ideas and telling me what I could do better, because I can, you know, I'm learning as well. It's just so much fun. I wouldn't have it any other way. Dirty PC, build a Hypercube. The Hypercube is a sick 3D printer. If you guys haven't seen it, go to Tech2C's channel. He's another Aussie, I think you're Aussie, I'm sorry. And he's got an awesome machine. It's an open source, very, very fast, Core XY style 3D printer. And Bryce over at his channel, he's built one and he's really happy with it. So just search Hypercube review and you'll find his video. Zorobyte, thank you so much, man. Esun PLA Pro, believe it or not, I haven't actually tested their Pro filament yet. I've tested their PLA till the cows come home, but I haven't tested the Pro. I'm actually trying to get some to test it. But from what I understand, it's very similar to some other brands of modified PLA like Polymax PLA. So you're going to get a very strong print, but support material may be harder to break away because it's less brittle. PLA supports tend to come away nicely. They sort of snap off. But from what I understand, these modified ones, they're stronger, like the PHA modified ones, but they tend to be a little bit more squishy, I guess, flexible, and therefore supports are a bit harder to remove cleanly. But just hold out for that one. I'm hopefully going to test it soon. But thank you so much for the support. Right. Prying Variables asking, why so many 3D printers here in AU? If you're asking about, like, people 3D printing in Australia, there's not really. There's very little. But in terms of what's happening here, there's a lot of innovation happening with 3D printing. There's where I am in Wollongong, there's the Wollongong University Innovation Campus where they're making nano diamond 3D printing filament to test thermal conductivity set things and properties. Crazy stuff. And they've got a metal printer. So yeah, there's not as much happening here as I would like, but there's still some cool stuff happening. Okay, just a couple more questions. Oh, did someone ask if it was pre-recorded? No, it's definitely not pre-recorded. I'm not the WAN show. Just joking, the WAN show isn't pre-recorded either. Right. Okay, Shadow is asking a good question. Actually, this, I'm going to put this one out to the Aussies. So, in Australia, going back to what I was saying before, there is a lot of cool innovation happening here, but it's also very difficult to get things. We are very far away from everywhere else in the world. Therefore, it's hard to get filaments, it's hard to get a range of build surfaces, and that sort of thing. So, for your build surface, BuildTac, I love them, but it's very expensive to get here. There is some really good suppliers, like the 3D printer, Dion, he's a great guy. Also, there's 3D Printing Systems, who supply a lot of printing supplies to schools and that sort of thing. And there's a lot of suppliers and resellers, but it's expensive. So what I tend to do is, if you want a BuildTac surface, think outside the box. Do you really need BuildTac, or maybe you can get away with glass? It's easy to get glass in Australia. It's easy to get glue. Glass and glue works well. So a lot of people with Wanhao i3s, once their BuildTac surface or fake BuildTac surface ran out or wore off, they put glass on their printers. But also, we're quite close to China, so it's quite easy to get like fake BuildTac and that sort of thing. But also, if you're in New South Wales, definitely hit up the Hobby King warehouse for filament. They have specials sometimes like you wouldn't believe. Keep an eye on it, because the shipping's like 10 bucks for 8 rolls if you're in New South Wales. Other states, a bit too expensive. But yeah, it's difficult in Australia. You just got to keep an eye out, get some suppliers you trust, and then you can get stuff. Or buy straight from China and wait a month for it to show up. And our poor dollar. Oh, poor dollar. The Australian dollar is just so bad these days. It's so expensive. Yeah, Arthur, going back to your question, why do I start streaming at 6 a.m.? Because I'm in Australia. It's currently 6 p.m. So yeah, actually, on that note, I will probably finish up, guys. So thank you for joining me. This was actually a lot of fun. I didn't expect many people to turn up, but loads of you did. I've barely caught up in the chat. And hopefully, if anyone watches this and you're new to 3D printing, this discussion will help you make a good decision. So I am going to plug my ebook. I did write an ebook last year on choosing properties of 3D printers. It doesn't specifically say what one to buy. It says what to look for and how to weigh it up against other characteristics. It's currently like $2 US or something because of our exchange rate. You can get that in the description of the video. But yeah, hopefully you guys learned something new, and let me know in comments if there's other questions, and I might do another one of these in future. And I look forward to streaming more in future because, yeah, I'm better now. So thanks for joining me, guys. I really appreciate it. And I look forward to seeing you again very shortly here on Maker's Muse. Thanks for everything, guys. Catch you later.